हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई एम अभय कुमार एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट द इश्यूज रिलेटेड टू आदिवासी एंड देयर स्ट्रगल फॉर देयर सर्वाइवल. द इश्यूज इंक्लूडेड द इशू ऑफ लाइफ, जल, जंगल, जमीन एंड रिसोर्सेस. आई थिंक वी आर वेरी हैप्पी एंड वी आर वेरी फॉर्चुनेट दैट टुडे वी आर बीइंग ज्वाइन बाय टुडे वी आर बीइंग ज्वाइन बाय ए डिस्टिंग्विश्ड एक्टिविस्ट. हिज नेम इज विजय सिंह रोनाल्ड डेविड. आई थिंक He has been struggling for the rights of the marginalized community, particularly Adivasis. Unfortunately, I think there has been a technical problem, and we are not being able to hear him live. So I am going to speak to him, and his voice you will be able to hear. And I think. Many things are not in our control. Net is not very strong there. You can just see it. Vijay Singh Ronald David is on the screen, but internet is not helping us. So, sir, welcome to this show, this Facebook live show. On this World Indigenous Day, I think we have got an opportunity to talk about the issues of Adivasi. I think we should not limit ourselves to talking about this issue only on a particular day. We have to talk and we have to discuss this issue every day in a year. So, sir, welcome. Please. Tell us about yourself. How did you become interested in Adivasi movement, and what do you think? Where has gone Adivasi movement today, and the struggle of the Aboriginal people and the crackdown by the state, sir?
Hello.
Yes, sir. Please continue. Yes.
I didn't start with working with the Adivasis. Initially, I started with the landless laborers and tenants way back in 76 and in South India near West Coast, Mangalore area.
Yes, sir.
After that, in 84, actually, the Adivasis approached us with two demands: help us to organize ourselves and build our own organization and do something for our children's education.
Yes,
so
sir.
That's where we started. And when we went to this particular village near Kushalnagar nearby, it is called Handikutta Kaval.
Yes, sir.
Where Soliga tribes are living.
Yes, sir.
And they were living like in a small nest like huts. They couldn't even walk through, they had to crawl through. And the thing what we found out was, due to hunger, to kill the hunger, they were eating mud. Just like groundnut, they used to roast it and eat. And the whole village, men were swollen body, having swollen body, and women were having 100% abortion, children were dying. The last child, which we took to the district hospital, surgeon said the D-Day can be postponed. And that child also we could not save. Then we started discussing with them. They said they don't have any facility and their details, no records were there in the government offices. So initially we took up small common issues. Started organizing them, and by gaining victory in small issues, solving the small issues like drinking water, they started telling that a lot of our people are sleeping, they have to be awakened. So I asked them, who has to do that? Then they said, we ourselves have to do it. And on their own, they went around, they brought 18 villages together within 1 year. And the Budakattu Krishikara Sangha was formed. Budakattu Krishikara Sangha means Tribal Cultivators Association. So through that, we started building up their self-confidence, getting away the fear what they had towards the landlords, police, and the government officials. And really, they started taking up smaller issues and gain self-confidence. So once this stage was over, we also started a formal, non-formal school in that village. Then we started moving to taking up bigger issues like land issue. As you know, land is not so easy to, that issue cannot be solved so easily. By taking up land issues, we were able to get back the land which they had lost in one village called Dotosu. 600 acres one strike. This as this created interest among the other communities. So the State Farmers Association, Rajya Raita Sangha, they came and they said, we are also distributing the land, and they started coming and trying to capture Adivasi land. So that's where some of the Adivasis were, one Adivasi got hurt, and there was a big struggle between the Adivasis and the farmers. Later on, the farmers were moved out from there by the administration, that is both Revenue and Forest Department, because these people, they started not only attacking the Adivasis, then capturing the Adivasi lands, and then also trying to take away the resources which was there in the forest, like sandalwood, stones, like that. So there was a joint operation by the Forest Department and the Revenue Department. So all the except Adivasis, all the other people were removed from that area. And these are the people who had land and estates. They too had come thinking that they can get land very cheaply by giving some money to this farmers' leaders, local leaders. Then there was a negotiation and all. Then that problem was solved. Later again, the Forest Department, the DFO came and he destroyed some of the agriculture products which was grown by the Adivasi. So then he was made to walk 8 kilometers. So he wanted to take a revenge. After 1.5 months, they came and they destroyed 80 houses. So later, they were assured by the district commissioner that they will not be thrown out, because people went on hunger strike for 3 days in front of the DFO's office. So by these actions, the Adivasi community started gaining confidence. Then they started taking up bigger issues like the eviction in Nagarhole National Park and the eco-development project, which was funded by the World Bank, where the Forest Department was using the these funds to evict Adivasi. Then we had to complain to the World Bank, and World Bank came to, they sent their inspection panel, and they found out there were prima facie violations. Then they stopped the funding. As a result, the forest department gave in writing that no forcible eviction will be there, and whoever wants to stay there, they will provide them some technical skills and also support for their education and health. Of course, after that, the evictions was reduced, forcible eviction, even though in a slow manner, they went on. Out of 1,550 families, they went on evicting the people from Nagarole to the rehabilitation area, where they promised initially 1 lakh was given, and they later 10 lakhs. So by undertaking that, all their rights, they are surrendering life. So this is one way of eviction which was going on. Hello.
Yes, sir. I can hear you, sir. Your voice is very loud and very proper. I think we have got the feedback that you are very much audible. Sir, I am asking that many people are interested about you, that when did you become interested, your interest in activism, particularly the issues related to Adivasi, what are your experiences?
That's what I was telling, no?
Yes.
So I started with Andikota Gaval in 1986, I told her, from that only.
No, no, I'm talking about your school life or something about your, yes.
Yeah. I'm born and brought up in Coorg.
Yes, sir.
Where we have a lot of forest areas, plus we have Adivasis.
Yes, sir.
About 10 different Adivasi groups are there.
Yes, sir.
And from my childhood, I have been seeing the Adivasis.
Yes, sir.
Because we used to stay in a coffee estate, and we used to go to the school, and we were growing up. So I had seen their life and their attachment with the forest and with the nature.
Yes, sir.
That is one thing. But later on, through my own personal experiences, like when I worked with the tenants, I was attacked by the landlords, and I was almost killed. Declaring I'm dead, the landlords left, but 99% of the tenants, they got the lands. This was during emergency when Land Reforms Act was implemented. So after that, I had to go through a lot of medical treatment. Then I came back. I went to Bombay, one of the biggest slums, Dharavi, and I underwent a training in community organization. After building up a powerful community which was fighting for their rights and the basic facility. So with all that, I came back to my own native place, and I started working with the rural people. I realized by the time I returned from Dharavi slums, that working in the slum areas and in the urban areas, we will create more slums. That time itself, more than 850 slums were there, and every day 350 families used to come to the slums from different parts of the country. We could get a picture that there is no one in the villages, especially in Tamil Nadu and all. So I came back to my own native place. I started working with the farmers issue when farmers were under threat of eviction in the name of development to convert the whole area from Kushalagar to Harangi as a Sundar Nagar. That was the dream of a then Chief Minister of the state, Mr. Gundurao, late Gundurao. So then while working on this farmers, the rural community issues, we were approached by the Adivasi. So like that, 86, I entered into Adivasi area. And since that time, we are basically focusing on Adivasi issues, especially on their livelihood rights and their cultural identity questions. So we took up this issue of mud eating and agitated them around that, and tried to help them to overcome that with a small support of getting them bullocks, and they started cultivating their food produce. Later on, after this struggle in Ranigate, we moved to Nagarwala issues, where the eviction was going on in the name of development, in the name of conservation. There was also land in Nagarwale core area was leased out to Tatas, and Tata was bringing building up the jungle in lodges. So we physically tried to stop that, and also we fought through legally by filing public interest litigation case both in the High Court and Supreme Court. We won the case, and they had to back up after spending about 2 crores. They tried to buy us, buy the leaders, but we had to say them, thank you, goodbye. So these are the struggles. Along with this, we also started taking up the Adivasi eviction issues and implement the forest rights issue. So we were very much involved in the PESA Act. Before PESA Act came, we started demanding that Adivasis should have a self-rule. So PESA Act was promoted. Though South India, we don't have this scheduled area, but still, once this law was passed, we started establishing the Adivasi self-rule in the villages. This gave us leverage to further fight along with other national movements and groups. So we took up the issue of Forest Rights Act to be passed. And 2006, as you know, that 2006 the Forest Rights Act was passed, which recognizes both individual and community rights. So individual rights,
yeah,
some of our people, Adivasis, they got, but still more than 50% still they are yet to get their individual rights recognized. Also, community rights, we were able to get in some parts, not fully, because there is no political will among the political leadership. The politician and the minister who was in charge when the actual implementation started in Nagarwala itself, measuring the land for community rights, it was stopped by oral instruction of the minister, then forest minister. So everywhere we find like this. It is not only in South India, it is all over the country. So later on, we built a national level network called National Adivasi Alliance. I am, at the moment, I am the national convener. So through this National Adivasi Alliance, we were actually pressurizing throughout the country to get this Forest Rights Act passed. Now the problem is 2006, the Forest Rights Act has been passed. Even now it is not implemented completely, not in the right spirit and the words. So the struggle continues. We are more concerned about the community rights, and people, if they get the community rights, their resource base, their livelihood resource base can be protected and managed by the forest Adivasis, and Gram Sabha has to be strengthened. All these years, the recognition has been delayed and denied, and people have come to the stage of thinking that this act is not going to be implemented. So the struggle still continues to get the rights recognized and take over the resource bases control, protect, and manage the forest.
Sir, I think you are more active in southern India, and
No,
we
not
have.
only southern India, we are also having our connected groups in Andhra, Orissa, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Rajasthan.
Okay, so I stand corrected. There has been a feeling that Adivasis are suffering in several parts of our country, but there is no unified struggle. No unified struggle. I have even seen in JNU that the issues of, let's say, Adivasis or tribals who are there in the northeastern states, they have a different set of agendas and programs, while the issue of displacement and then exploitation of the resources are very central in central state.
Yeah, central state, more Adivasi concentration is there. At the same time, southern states are totally neglected. Southern states are not been recognized as scheduled areas. That is another problem. So they cannot have self-rule, but with the Forest Rights Act passing, still people are trying to use this self-governance through Gram Sabhas, which is a ground-level democratic process, which has to be strengthened, and people should get back their freedom, which they had lost, and they have to own the resource basis, and they have to manage. As Birsa Munda said, all these natural resources are resource base of the communities. It cannot be owned by any government. But what is happening? Most of these resource bases are given to the multinationals, big companies, mining companies, and to take away the resources, they are evicting the people forcibly. And whoever questions and challenges, they have been branded as Naxalites or anti-nationals, extremists, and they are killed. Many people are killed. I had been to the Chhattisgarh area. In that area, the young people are threatened. Either they have to join the police and kill their own brothers and sisters, or they are branded as Naxalites and they can be put behind bars or they can be killed. Instead of giving them skills and knowledge, they are accepting their knowledge, whatever knowledge Adivasis have. They are being treated in their own lands as extremists. They are treated as outsiders. They are treated as anti-nationals. So how can you expect changes? And see, the people who extract and loot, not only in India, but also in places like Australia. Australia, the Aboriginal's lands has been taken for mining by our Adani, and our people have expressed solidarity with the indigenous people of Australia. And after extracting, they are planning to bring it to Jharkhand. There they want to generate power and supply to Bangladesh, where already power is in excess. In spite of that, they want to dump on that. At the same time, these Adani and Ambani groups, they are getting subsidies from India, getting subsidy from Australia, subsidy also from Bangladesh. So there is a planned and determined way of taking away the Adivasis resource bases and separating the Adivasis and taking over. And earlier, as I said, I started with the Land Reforms Act. What has happened in Karnataka? Land Reforms Act has been changed now. Now anybody can purchase. Earlier it was land to the tiller. Now anybody can purchase the land, even up to 100 hectares. So how can we protect our land, water, and forest? That is the question. So it's a long struggle.
Do you see?
Along with this, there is also, natural calamities and all, which is pushing and slowing down the process.
Sir, I think early in this year, I think it was in the month of February or March, I think last year, it was a big issue, displacement. A large number of millions of people were having facing this threat to be displaced. So for time being, the issue was put to cold back.
In that also, because the people gave a threat that okay, this cannot be allowed because the on behalf of the Adivasis, there was no representation by the present government. So the court had taken a decision without understanding about the law and the procedures, whether they have followed. Without following the procedures, because of their mistake, more than 20 lakh people would have been evicted. So we have also consulted some lawyers, and some lawyers have filed a case in the Supreme Court. Plus, there was a protest all over the country. Then, when they also wanted to bring in changes in the forest policy, we have questioned that. So last time, when national level the protest was called, and we expressed our solidarity in local areas, and it was withdrawn, timing. Otherwise, they want to bring in changes. All these changes in the laws now they are bringing in, including Forest Rights Act, because Forest Rights Act clearly says there should be clearance from the Gram Sabha. So they tried their maximum. When they cannot get that all their tricks to get the approval from the Gram Sabha, they wanted to bring in the changes in the Forest Rights Act itself. So that has been withheld now, and this new forest policy, national forest policy, and then now here in Karnataka they have brought in this Land Reforms Act change. So everywhere, according to their benefits, they are changing without considering these communities, without caring for the nature, without understanding that unless and until the Adivasi communities, their rights are recognized, their freedom is given back, and they should be made as custodians of the forest cannot be saved, or the biodiversity cannot be saved. And it is proved wherever the Adivasis are there, biodiversity is intact. Where it is under the control of the Forest Department, it has become just plantations. Plantations cannot be forest. And recently, after collecting the money from the diverting the forest lands, more than 60,000 crores. They wanted to, first it was rent, and then it become Campa become CAFAT. So they have money through the backdoor entry. Again, they want to come weaken the Forest Rights Act and take away the forest lands and continue with the plantation. So Forest Department and the politicians are just looking forest as a commodity to make money.
Sir,
The
I
communities are not seeing forest as a commodity. Forest is part of their life. For their gods, their life is life, cultural roots, everything is in the forest itself.
Sir, I think this discussion is being watched by a lot of young people, and they are inspired by good idea. They want to see society based on equality. So we know that what is happening for resources, for making profit. I think lives are being destroyed, resources are being exploited. So we know this fact, this bitter truth. But I feel sometimes very sad that still, I think your work is commendable, and I think there are many people like you, but still we feel that a lot needs to be done, particularly for people who could put forth the issue of Adivasi and who could advocate that issue. And I think that political parties have also largely failed to stand with Adivasi community. So
yes.
my question is here very pointed. Can we have any hope from the political party, or do you see any change, or any, you could say, the difference between one set of political party or another set of political party, or our only hope is a struggle and our only hope is people's movement? I think
there is no hope from the political parties, because we have seen both the political parties. When Congress was in power, they were telling Congress was not in power. They said, we are not in power. We cannot do anything. We cannot implement. When the BJP came to power, they didn't do anything. So both are equally responsible, and they are same. They don't have political will to implement this Forest Rights Act, which is one of the wonderful and greatest laws after British laws. Right from the turning point started from the Peace Act 1996. But even now it is not implemented, and they will not implement. By implementing, they may have the fear that they will lose the hold of the people. That's what we could strongly feel. So the only hope is all these Adivasis have to come together. They have to continue with their struggle. The struggle is the only way they can get back their land, get back their freedom, and stop eviction.
Sir, and what we can do, particularly people at university, the students, the civil society members, what they can do on their part? You have any suggestions, sir?
Yeah, see, lot of civil society members.
Students, particularly, activist students, sir, activist students.
Yeah, activist students. See, earlier, just to remind you that 1975, like emergency time, Jayaprakash Narayan gave a call for the total revolution. Lot of students came out, joined the struggle. One of my mentor and guru, they were who came out from the priesthood and joined the students' movement as well as the Adivasi struggles, taking up issues. So that type of thinking is not there among the youths today. Most of the youth think that they have to get their IT education, then work in the IT field, and go for all these malls and supermarkets, and then all these gadgets and cars and all. Only facilities they look, and they are not bothered about the fellow human beings and people who have protected and managed the forest till now, and who are deprived of all the benefits of the modern thing. But everything is done in the name of development, and they are deprived, and they are the actual first people of the world who have been treated as last people of the world. And their voices are not heard. So at least student activists, students who are interested in justice, students who are interested in protecting the nature, students who are interested about the Adivasis who are living in harmony with the nature, I think they all should express their solidarity to the struggles of the Adivasis. Then Adivasi voice can be increased. We also try to bring the South Indian level Adivasis together to discuss about their issues and plan out the action. Through Sangamas, more than 8 Sangamas we had organized. In that, even the national level Adivasis had participated. And the last Sangam was in 2011, where we thought that only Adivasis fighting will not be able to achieve anything. They will not get their rights and stop the eviction. So we brought all the communities who are dependent on the natural resources, like fishermen, the Adivasis, the Dalits, the women and children. And it was called கம்யூனிட்டி ரைட்ஸ் அண்ணமா
சார்
கம்யூனிட்டி ஷுட் இன்வால்வ் இன் த ஸ்ட்ரகிள் ஆஃப் த ஆதிவாசி இன் ப்ரொடெக்டிங் த கம்யூனிட்டிஸ் ஹூ ஆர் டிபெண்ட் ஆன் நேச்சர் ஹூ ஆர் ப்ரொடெக்டிங் த நேச்சர்
Sir, before I ask you one another questions, I want to tell our viewers, our friends who are watching it, that today is tomorrow. In fact, tomorrow is the World Indigenous Day for Indigenous Day. I think International Day for Indigenous Peoples, 9th of August. And on this occasion, we are now talking with Bijay Singh Ronald David. He's activist and he has been struggling for long for the landless people, and he has even staked his life for them. And we have just talked about the issues related to resources and how resources are being exploited and how political parties have completely failed us, and there is no difference between one set of political party and another set of political party. And that is how that is why the right thinking people, the activists, the students should come together and should stand for bringing about justice and equality in society. Sir, thank you very much. I think you are also interested in liberation theology, so we now I'm going to ask some questions related to that religion and identity, which are very controversial. And I want to begin with giving this reference that when a Bhumi Pujan, that laying foundation ceremony, was done by Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi, that was a violation of India's secularism. A leader of the country cannot be allowed to publicly associate with any puja or any worship of any particular community or particular religious group. What has happened that when I was going through the newspapers, I found one very small story. It was published in Prabhat Khabar from Ranchi, and that story carried that newspaper carried a story, and one person claiming to be Sarna Adivasi, he said that I feel very proud and happy that we brought some soil from our own society and it was taken to Ayodhya, and it was we brought it there. In this way, the impression was being created that Adivasi is with Hindutva project. I think we do not know how far this story is true. So I am just citing this example to bring to your notice the very fact that Hindutva forces have been, and they are very much active to co-opt. They are trying their best to co-opt Adivasi community. And that is why the old debate is still very relevant, that why Adivasis are not allowed to write their name under their own religion. That options is not there. So, and then there is also a vested interest, which is vested interest, very active among Adivasis to create a division between Adivasi people on the basis of religion, and then Christian missionaries are being demonized, that they are here to disturb society. So we know all this debate, and sir, you have been inspired, and you know a lot about liberation theology. So many people, many of us who do not know much about it, please tell us about what is this liberation theology, and how could Adivasi be united? A Adivasi is free to become a member of any particular faith, but Adivasi cannot be divided on the basis of religion. How could we foil that nefarious design by the Hindutva forces? Sir, your comment on that.
See, Adivasis are not Hindus or Muslims or Christians. First, worldwide, if you see also, Adivasis, they are the nature worshippers. They worship their ancestors. So they are having their faith in the natural nature. Okay. So now they are forcibly made to think they are Hindus. For example, here in our area, the Jainakurba, Hindu they put. Jainakurba, how he can become Hindu? So they are made to mentally think now they are Hindus and they are forced to follow the Hindu rituals and all, forgetting their own rituals. So slowly some leaders, they are understanding, which is not right. But systematically, there is attempt to make the Adivasis to feel that they are Hindus. And then the Adivasis who got some education or support from the Christian missionaries, they have been attacked, especially in the central part of India, and it is spreading all over. And what you said is that the Bhumi Puja, that I think being a prime minister of the country, he has every right, like every citizen, he can personally worship anything, any temple or anywhere. But as a prime minister, going and recognizing...
And sir, it was telecast. Sir, it was telecast. Sir, it was telecast.
Pardon?
It was telecast. The program was telecast by all the channels, including Doordarshan.
And I think that is a very bad thing, and that sets an example that we are all Hindus like. How can it be? We are Indians, but we have our own faith and our own understanding. See, I am not a very staunch religious person, but my community and religious thoughts were always about caring and sharing of the fellow human beings, and respecting the nature, and then care for the fellow human being and love the fellow human being, not hate. But the hate politics is going on nowadays. And that is especially disturbing very much. And it is actually misguiding a lot of the youths without understanding the reality, without understanding the life. People are getting, young people are getting trapped into that, which is a very sad thing.
Yes, Hello? Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please continue.
My this liberation theology, I have not read, but I have heard from the people who are struggling, for example, people from Philippines and all, who were very much involved in liberation theology. And there was Korean theology, which is called people's theology. So some of these things which are identifying with the people, struggling people, and involved in the struggle, that has inspired quite a lot. And the theology, for theologians, there was an orientation to make them understand about the society, how in the society people are living with one meal per day, or without roof, or people having three meals and all the luxuries. To understand this, the orientation camp was organized for the theologians. Fortunately, I was told by one of our priests to attend that. By attending that, I understood how the exploitation goes on in the villages. And that is where I was forced, or I was motivated to work for the tenants and landless people. And after seeing the violence and people who were evicted from their lands, and their lands were taken away, I thought this is an injustice, and I should continue to work. And I wanted to go back and work in the same place. But one of my mentors, he said, it is better for, due to political reasons, to keep away. That is where I landed up again in my native place. And I started working with the rural communities who were under threat of eviction because of industrial estate and other developmental plans of the then chief minister. And in the process, people heard about our my involvement and activities. The Adivasis approach since 84, we have been working with Adivasi.
Sir, a friend of mine had just sent a question for you. It is the question is about nomadic denotified Adivasi, and the friend is asking that they have not got a citizenship right. So on this Indigenous Day, International Indigenous Day, what is your suggestions?
Nomadic tribe from where?
All over.
Yeah, all over the world, nomadic groups are there, gypsies and all. They move around.
The friend is saying that Maharashtra and Gujarat, the issue of nomadic denotified tribe, Banjara people, and they have
Banjara,
not got.
Yes, I know Banjara people. Yes.
Yes, sir. So you are
Banjara people. In some areas, they are recognized as tribes. In some states, they are not. They are recognized as scheduled caste.
So the question is that could you suggest some ways that that could go to improve their conditions and bring them to the mainstream?
See, some of the these nomadic tribes, some of them are settled down also now, and they are leading a good life. There is a need for these communities also to join the larger struggles of the Adivasis. If they fight isolately, I think it is difficult, because one is they are scattered and then they are moving. Of course, nowadays these movements has reduced. Not much you can see. The nomadic tribes. And they are also losing their livelihood skills and also bases.
Sir, I think I asked a question earlier and that we could not spend much time on that. That why in census there is not a separate place for Adivasi to have their choice what religion they want to follow. Why they should be forced to follow one of the major religions, either you are a Hindu or any other member of the religious community. Why not they are given this choice? What is this politics?
The politics is by keeping them like that, they can be used as vote banks.
Sir, kindly elaborate on that, sir.
Vote banks.
Yes.
And then the people also had not demanded for a Adivasi religion. I think there is
sir,
thinking is going on.
Sir, some friends have told me that in Jharkhand and in other neighboring states, I think members from Sarna religion, matlab Sarna Adivasi, they are asking and they are saying that they are not Hindus, and in census they should be given a space, a column, so that they could assert their identity and they could not, they could resist the very effort to be co-opted within the larger Hindu community.
Yes. The this consciousness is slowly spreading. People here also, they think that they are not Hindus and they are Adivasis. So they should write Adivasi, Jinkurba, or Adivasi, Soliga, Adivasi, Yarava, or Adivasi, Betakurba, or like that. That consciousness is slowly coming and
So, sir, do you consider it as a...
It can be reality. For that also, there is a need for collective struggle.
So do you support such movements, sir? Do you think
yes,
that...
Yes, I'll support.
Okay. Sir, I think one question is also very much controversial. I think SC, Scheduled Tribes and Scheduled Castes, if you look at their... the development and indices, you will find that largely both are at the bottom of of developmental
index.
I know that that it is also a fact that compared to Adivasi community, SC community has become slightly more vocal, and they have got a good number of civil society groups and research groups, and some media groups are also coming up. But I have to also accept this fact that they are nowhere compared to mainstream media or the resources available with the dominant caste and classes. But somehow a division is also, by the vested interest, a division is also being created, and it is being propagated. Oh, look at what Dr. Ambedkar has done for Adivasi,
yeah.
And he has made some controversial statement in inhalation of caste. So deal with such divisive propaganda, and how to bring SC and ST together, because they are largely at the bottom of the society, sir.
Yeah. See, the SCs, whatever the Prevention Act was there, SC-ST Prevention Act, when you look back, how many actually got the justice, or how much action has been taken? The data shows that not much. Okay. The same way, the Dalits have education, and because of the education, they have reached to some good positions in the government also. But it is not the case with the Adivasis. So there is a need for education, not just the education what we get in at the present without any values, but with the values of the Adivasis, and they have to get the education in their language. And once they are educated and they get their rights recognized, and they're conscious about SCs also, that unless and until we come together and fight, we will not be able to do much. I think things cannot change. So only thinking that we are separate and they are separate, I think it is not going to help. There will be a lot of people who are trying to break the unity.
Yes, yes.
But we have to work towards bringing all these communities which are dependent on natural resources, and then as a force, it has to address the issues. Then only there is some hope.
Sir, I have got so many questions, but we don't have much time. We have to close it in 1 hour. So we have got 10 minute maximum. One question is about Adivasis in Assam, in Tea Garden in Assam. And the question is that that Adivasi jo Assam ke chai bagan mein hai, unko Adivasi nahi mana jata hai, 20% population se zyada hai wahan. The question is that Adivasis who are working in tea bagan, tea bagan, their population is around 20%, I think, as it has been claimed. I don't know, I have to check the fact. So, and they are mostly from Jharkhand area, Jharkhand state. So they are not recognized as Adivasi, and if you don't recognize them, then they are deprived of whatever little a state is offering to them. So what can we do to them?
See, the problem, I have also seen some video clippings and all the people, the Adivasis who go and work in the tea estates, they have been lynched also and killed. So, if they are not recognized as Adivasis and if they are not getting benefits, I think there is only way that they have to join the other Adivasi struggles and then put up their demands. Unless collectively they put their efforts, isolated way if they fight as tea garden workers and all, they, it is very difficult to achieve anything.
So you think that their issue, the issue of tea gardeners in Assam, these issues are being taken up by, let's say, the activists and policy makers.
Yes.
So are you hopeful that they will get justice, or what students, activists can do?
Student activists and the trade unions, they have to take it up. If they don't take it up, they will lose their identity and their power also. Already we can see in West Bengal and all. And Assam, there is also a problem of this very question of identity, that CAA and NRC issues.
Yes, sir.
So many people, they will not get even citizenship. They will be thrown out. So unless and until all these people who are threatened or suffering, they have to join the struggles of the Adivasis and then continue to fight their issues at a larger scale.
Sir, another very controversial issue. I think several journalists have also written it from, let's say, Assam and Northeast, that the communal forces have been able to, this is the claim, I don't know, this is the claim, that the communal forces have been able to mobilize Adivasis against minority Muslim. So yeah, how far is it true? How far is it true? And if it is true, what we can do?
It is true. In Gujarat, you have seen the Adivasis are used, and Adivasis are used in Jharkhand, Orissa. Many places Adivasis are used to fight against the Muslims and also other minorities like Christians.
So from
the state, politics is getting more and more into many areas.
But sir, I am asking, what is the point where, or what is the gray area where the Hindutva forces are able to exploit them? Where we have made wrong, or
the problem is, Hindutva forces are thinking that, okay, suppose if I am a Christian, I am trying to convert, like I proved, I challenged. You produce one person, they could not, but they make a propaganda, and they tried to inject in the people's mind that, oh, these people are converting, and you they are trying to make money, and they will offer something, but without doing anything also, people have come out in our own area. Lot of Adivasis have felt, or they, some sicknesses, they have gone to some priest, and that priest has prayed and given some medicine or something, and it is cured, and with that they have changed their faith into Christianity. So like that, people are going, but the other communal forces are thinking that, okay, any work with the Adivasis, the voiceless people, that is a conversion work, which is not true.
Sir,
people have to get the, people have to understand, especially the Adivasis, they have to understand what they want, and it is better for Adivasis also to continue with their own religious beliefs and practices, cultural practices, which is much more greater than all these religions, because they have a wider worldview, and they are much more high level of thinking which the whole world is looking forward to learn from the Adivasi way of life.
Sir,
How they live in harmony with the nature and how they protect and how they manage, what are the values which contributes to upkeep and protect and manage the biodiversity and taking care of the nature and caring for the fellow human being and equality among themselves, both men and women, including children and elders.
Sir, I think whatever we are discussing, that the communal angle and also an appropriation of the subaltern classes for Hindutva project, I think these issues are also linked with what we have seen in Kandamal over the years.
Yes.
So if you could say something about that, because without discussing them and referring to them, I don't think that our discussion can be complete. Yes, Kandamal is
Kandamal also, see, this hate politics was induced, and you see that people without any expectation who were working, those father and children were burnt. After that, what happened? So many of the churches and all were destroyed. Rapes took place. Good thing or good religion? No religion, I think, will teach that you do all these things and violence to establish your hegemony. But we have seen in Kandamal, lot of people were killed and so much of destruction of the churches, houses, then rapes, and now it is spreading all over the country. It's happening everywhere.
Sir, last question. We know that Adivasi is also being demonized for being militant by the mainstream media, by militant and by for resorting to violent means. So you understand where I'm referring to, that so some people are also saying that they are sandwiched between a state and let's say those who are waging militant struggle. So how far is that true, and your any insight, your comment on that issue, sir?
No, I told no when I visited this Chhattisgarh area, it is what it Bastar area and all, Bastar, and where there was so many police officers for CRP people were killed. After that, I had the opportunity to go with some retired vice chancellors and other in a peace march. So that time we saw all these young people, they are given AK-47. Instead of giving AK-47, they could have given them some skills and some education, no? And if there is situation is changed, if they are given better facilities, where is the necessity for any Naxalite from outside also to come there? So instead of addressing their issues, giving facilities and seeing them as Indian citizens, they are creating war. I have told several times, the government is reason to create Naxalites. It is not the Naxalites, just they will come like that.
I think I read a book of Arundhati Rai, and I think, yes, if I am correct, she made a reference that the presence of security personnel
they are occupying the schools. So where is the school for the children of the Adivasis?
And she
the
said,
schools are occupied by the police.
And she said,
AK-47.
And she said that the ratio of the security personnel and the population, that ratio is higher in Adivasi area than even in Kashmir. I think if I'm correct, she made some some reference there. And she also said that big, let's say, corporate players who are otherwise seen as a very liberal and progressive and doing great social work, they are also involved in abetting and also helping.
They are involved in coming and digging and taking away, looting away all the resources. All these Adivasi bases are resource rich. The Adivasis are sitting on the gold, golden bed. So they want to take away all the resources from there. So they have to create some conflict. They have to brand people as Naxalites, and they have to kill them in the encounters or in the police custody, so that it will be easy and clear for them to loot whatever they want.
Sir, I think we have already crossed 1 hour our
yeah.
deadline, and once again I want to reiterate that today on this indigenous International Indigenous Peoples Day, we are just talking about the state of Adivasi in India, and Bijay Singh
it
Ronald
is not only India, the same situation is there in many countries of the world.
Okay, so we are talking
they are
about
not
the
willing to recognize their right, because I was participating in an international tenure facility meeting some 2 years back in Hyderabad. It is the same issues where some governments are sensible, where political leaders, they are sensible, they are trying to recognize their rights and give the land to the Adivasi communities, realizing that they are, it is actually with the Adivasi communities the forest can be protected and managed better.
So sir, could you suggest to us,
and always there is no point in just celebrating the indigenous world indigenous day and all without recognizing their rights, stopping all the forcible eviction and looting and taking away all the resource bases and make them poor and voiceless.
Sir, I think this discussion and this show is being watched by many researchers and young activists and students. If you could give us a brief reference to some of important works, or maybe some of the model which we can read and we could know more about that, so that we stand in a better position to understand and put forth the issue of Adivasi. Something from your research or maybe your experience that you want to share here.
We had been for exposure to Mandalika area, where Adivasis, after getting this for community rights, they are protecting and managing. And today in the Gram Sabhas, they have 3 crores to 5 crores cash. And they are protecting, they have taken the responsibility, they are managing, and they have got the bank account in the name of Gram Sabha. They have a PAN card in the name of Gram Sabha. And they are also raising the forest and managing the whole activities by themselves. If you give the rights completely recognized as per this law, because this law itself came to undo the historical injustice. But what you are doing? After law was passed in 2006, we are in 2020. It has not been implemented. Then how can you get the injustice undo? And then you are taking away all the resources, you are handing over to multinational companies, you are making still these Adivasis poor and voiceless.
Friends, Bijay Singh Ronald David he's available on social media, he's available on Facebook, and I think you can Google his name and you can get to know about his organizations. I think his presence and his coming to this show and experience and sharing his experience about the struggle of the landless people and also the Adivasi movement. They have really enriched us, and I think this is just the beginning. I think this is just the beginning. I cannot claim that all our questions have been answered, but we should feel happy that a beginning has been made, and a real activist, an activist who is working on the ground, has become our friend. We have come to know him. So we will definitely go back to you, sir, and seek your guidance and also learn about you. Finally, before I conclude and end this broadcast, I think
Thank
if you,
you so much,
sir, one second. If you have to say some concluding remarks, some messages you have to give very briefly, sir, in 2 minutes, maybe you just give it. Maybe that many people have joined this show or this Facebook Live of late, they could also be benefited. Very concrete and very, what should I say, very focused message to us, to people who really feel that that justice and equality should be given to everybody, including Adivasi. Sir, your last message, sir, here.
Yeah. See, our motto itself, born in under society, we shall not die in it until we change it. So that's why we are working. Let us fight and work together. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think now this show comes to an end. And I thank everybody for listening to it and participating in it, and also those who send their questions, they are also to be thanked. So this program comes to an end. Thank you, friends. I think I will again do another Facebook Live show next time, with another burning issues. Thank you very much, Vijay Singh, Ronald David, for giving time. Thank you, sir. Okay.
Thank you so much for this opportunity. Okay.